Danny, just a few days ago, thousands of previously classified documents pertaining to the death of President John F. Kennedy were released. Here to break down what's new and what is not, please welcome back historian Feliks Banel. It's good to have you here. So let's talk about how this batch was released. And we thought at first it was going to be everything, and then it wasn't.
Yeah, well, about 25 years ago, they released a bunch of JFK assassination files, but they held back about 4,000 documents on the grounds that, you know, this was CIA material, mm-hmm. FBI material. It might compromise investigations, might compromise their methods of investigations.
Right.
So they gave them 25 years to sort through everything and figure out what could be released. And at the very last minute, they held back a little bit of the material. That won't come out until April of 2018, so another 180 days. It's that same idea that it might compromise either specific individuals or specific methods of investigation, or it's just stuff they haven't gotten to yet. It's kind of hard to imagine. I guess we won't know until we actually see it.
They had 25 years to look at it.
I think they're actually trying to fuel the conspiracy. They were worried the conspiracy might go away with all these other documents. How can we kind of keep it going for another 6 months? Let's hold
That'll
on some of the documents.
That'll make us suspicious. Yeah. But there are, you know, ancestors who were involved in this who have people living now or families who might be involved. So I'm glad they're being really careful. I mean, not involved in the assassination, but involved in the case. So what did we learn from this release that we didn't know before? Because some of the documents we've seen before, but they're less redacted now, right?
I don't think there's anything really earth-shattering, but it's a lot more texture. I think some of the stuff that stood out for me, I think the day after the assassination, the FBI received a call from someone who said they were part of a committee in Dallas that was going to kill Lee Harvey Oswald.
The day after?
Yeah, this would be the Saturday after Kennedy was assassinated. They said, we're going to kill Lee Harvey Oswald. So the FBI reached out to the Dallas police, and they were assured, we'll protect him.
Right.
They reached out to him again Sunday morning and said, there's been this death threat. But you know, they lead Oswald from the city jail to the county jail, and Oswald gets assassinated himself by Jack Ruby. So they didn't really take any extra precautions, though they'd been warned twice by the FBI.
And Ruby,
so that was new.
Was familiar to the police department,
he was. He owned a couple of nightclubs, a carousel club, like a strip club in Dallas there, and was well known to a lot of people. So he was able to get into that city jail parking garage, just be like, hey, Jack, everyone knew who he was for the most part. Yeah, and that's not new, but this notion that they'd received warnings, whether the warning was actually connected to Jack Ruby or not is a whole other question.
We don't know.
But the fact that Dallas police were encouraged by the FBI to provide as much security as possible for Oswald, that's new.
And they didn't appear to do that.
No, and they were the FBI, particularly J. Edgar Hoover, who was the FBI director almost for life. He was the director of the FBI from the 30s to the 70s, a very flamboyant character, very vindictive. He was very disappointed by that. And he was worried, this also came out in this document, these documents, he was worried that the conspiracy would grow. He was really thought there should be some way to convince the American people that Oswald really was the assassin. Mm-hmm. Some kind of almost like a trial in absentia of the dead Oswald to prove to the American people that it wasn't a conspiracy.
And that didn't really work because we've had all kinds of theories since then.
So, industry, yeah.
Yeah, an industry. So 54 years and we're still, I don't know if it's an obsession, but obviously people are really interested and there isn't a satisfaction that we know for a fact what happened.
Yeah, it's almost too perfect the way you have this Oswald, who's a very strange character. He'd been a Marine, he'd defected, he'd lived in the Soviet Union, married a Soviet woman, brought her back. He was at the Soviet embassy in Mexico City about a month or two before the assassination. He did all this stuff that looked like he was part of some conspiracy, but he's almost like that quintessential American character, the lone gunman, mm-hmm. who's able to kill somebody, and then he himself is killed 2 days later.
And we have no
answers. We're left speculating 54 years later. Yeah.
Didn't he say when he was in Mexico that he was going to kill JFK?
It's not clear what he said. He was trying to get back to the Soviet Union, and they thought he was mentally unstable, and they pretty much said, you can't come back to the Soviet Union. It turned out in these documents, we learned that the person he talked to at the embassy was some KGB official from Department 13. I mean, that sounds ominous. That's the part of the KGB associated with assassinations and sabotage. Mm-hmm. Imagine what that guy's business card must say, right?
Yeah. So it's just a black card.
So the plot in some ways thickens from these documents, and it also is just sort of this more texture. One other oddball thing, a newspaper in Cambridge, England, about 25 minutes before the assassination, got an anonymous phone call. It's early evening, you know, England time, saying, call the American embassy for some big news. You know, this is 25 minutes before the assassination. Whether there's any connection or whether it's just a prank caller, who knows?
Right.
But that made it up to the FBI and into the files and was held back 25 years ago and then is released now.
You've been to Dealey Plaza, right?
Yeah, I did about 25 years ago. My wife and I were driving through Texas. We got to pull off into Dallas and see Dealey Plaza. We didn't know where we were going. We didn't have smartphones back mm-hmm. then, right? We had an atlas. We're opening it up. As we were driving, the road starts to make that really familiar, mm-hmm. bizarre curve, and we were on the assassination route. I mean, we looked up over the window, and you could see the book depository there in the moonlight. It was bizarre. 10 o'clock on a Saturday night, we went out to the Zapruder spot where the famous guy shot the home movie.
Right.
I thought we might be the only people there. There were several dozen people there doing the same thing.
There are always
this is 1992.
People there.
Yeah, this is 25 years ago, but it's It's captured the American imagination. That clip, that Zapruder clip, in my mind, that's the first YouTube clip, like 50 years before YouTube.
Talk about viral.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, people didn't actually see it until about 10 years after the assassination, right. But the FBI had it and they were analyzing it. And I think that's part of the reason that the fascination continues. If we didn't have motion picture footage of that Lincoln, you know, pulling down the toward the triple underpass and then the shots being fired, we wouldn't have these stark, these indelible images that have stayed with us for so long.
Well, what do you think about what we know from the film and what we know from the ballistics? Because there are these people who say it's just not possible for bullets to do what these bullets did.
Yeah, the magic bullet theory,
that
one bullet. I tend to not really believe conspiracy theories very much. It makes me kind of a boring person, I guess, but it's fun. And it's,
well,
it's,
you're a historian,
yeah,
not a
I like the facts, and I think it's just there's part of us that wants to believe conspiracy theories, the same way we like to tell ghost stories around the campfire and kind of wonder what that sound is beyond the edge of the fire and the bushes, the cracking in the bushes and stuff. We like that notion of being sort of our heart race, at least mine does. I mean, as a child, as a young man, I thought the conspiracy theory was pretty credible. But as the years have rolled on, it seems like it would be impossible to cover it up properly. I mean, look at, you know, it's just, too many people would have talked, or somehow the word would have gotten out, unless it was just a brilliant, brilliant conspiracy that fooled even me.
I hope someday we'll know for a fact.
I don't think
somebody can button it up.
I don't think we'll ever know.
That's probably true. Yeah. It happened a long way from Seattle, but obviously everybody had a reaction. What was it like in Seattle at that time?
Yeah, so it's a week or so before Thanksgiving. That Saturday was supposed to be the Apple Cup. It was only the second annual. It had been called the Apple Cup the year before, and that was postponed for a week. Down at the Navy bases at Pier 91 and Sand Point and Bremerton Navy Yard, because Kennedy was a naval vet, every half hour, on the half hour, they fired a single gun salute. Mm. The whole city pretty much shut down. Public TV went off the air, the local TV station. They didn't know what to do. They just shut it off. All the local programming was canceled, and they went with national network programming. This was the first time that America really watched something happening in real time at their TV sets. I mean, TV had really come of age in the 1950s, and the networks had the ability to go live to Dallas, live to Washington, D.C., and then as the weekend progressed, you know, you saw Kennedy, the White House activity on Saturday, lots of people saw Oswald get shot on live TV on Sunday morning. It was, I mean, TV, like, if there were any doubts about TV becoming a force in American culture and history, those doubts were erased that weekend. It became this ubiquitous appliance you had to have to know what was going on. And it sort of united people in their mourning. That's media comforts people and let them connect with each other during tough times like that.
That's true. And there were just three channels, so we were all experiencing this the same way.
Yep.
Feliks, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm disappointed that you don't believe in my conspiracy theory. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
I just want to know. Up next, important safety tips for runners as it gets dark a lot earlier. We'll be back after this.